move, she's close to her church. And the next move, I'm close to the church. So we've never worked it out so that both of us are close to churches we serve.
I see. Right.
That looks like Gary. Yes, it is.
Hi, Gary.
Hi, Gary. Your microphone is still off. So.
Yes, my microphone will be off, and I'm actually going to mute everybody when we begin.
Nice to meet you, Gary, face-to-face.
Yes, absolutely.
Thanks for coming up with this creative idea.
My wife is mainly to thank, so right. We should be thanking her.
Good. Whomever. Is she an ordained minister as well?
No, she works at the conference office, actually.
Oh, okay.
She's the registrar for the conference office.
I didn't make that connection. Okay, fine. Next time I'll have to, I have something to share with her. Ask her how her hubby's doing.
Hi, Linda. Did you get all squared away?
It's not going to work.
Oh, because I saw your candle for a while.
I know, but then it's too close to where I'm sitting and I was going to knock it, and the table isn't very sturdy and I was afraid it was going to knock over and then I would burn the house down, the apartment building down. Yeah.
I used battery candles last night.
No, that's a good idea.
I had really great intentions of having, design, but it's what it is, right?
Well, at least you know what it was going to look like.
I should have took a picture of it.
Yeah, that's what I was just gonna say.
I've dismantled.
Gary, I was going to stay on just for a little bit at first, and then because I'm not on until 2, and then join back in. Is that? I assume that's.
Of course.
Cool. So yes. Working on my Easter message. So flip flopping between Good Friday and Easter. I mean, isn't this such a surreal time this week? Or?
It is. Absolutely. Yeah, I'm probably going to be here, but I'll make my screen dark just so other people can do their time. So.
Okay, great. Thank you.
So we're going to all be muted until it's our turn. Is that?
Yep. You can either unmute yourself or I will be here to unmute you if you happen to forget.
Okay. Yeah. If I start talking and you see my lips moving and you're not hearing me, let me know.
So I could even just stay on the call and just take my, I have a picture in place of me, and just turn off audio. That maybe I'll just do that. It'll be easier. Yeah.
How do you do that, Francis?
There's, if you can move your cursor to the very bottom of your screen, on the left, there's a video picture and a little microphone picture. And if you tap each of those buttons, you're going to, like right now, I just closed off my audio. You just see a picture of me. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to turn my audio back on I'm going to turn my audio back on. So now I'm with you again.
Oh, so how did you get a picture instead of just the blank, your name? You have to. You can choose a virtual background.
You can do that. I haven't done that, but you can do that. That's one option. Another option is you can put in your own picture. And I'm trying to remember, I think I went under Zoom settings to do that. I do have a Zoom account. So with my Zoom account, that's how I did that.
Oh, I see. Okay. I have a Zoom account now too.
So you play, if you go into settings, you'll be able to see. Yeah, it took me a little while, but I figured it out. All these things takes me a little while.
I like your background. It's very nice.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Yeah. I worked a little with that.
Yeah. Sorry. I was working on Easter Sunday morning service this morning while it was still dark outside. Because that has to go in today in order to get it to be, this has been a fairly demanding week in terms of writing. I keep reminding people ask me about it. I said, well, inspiration does not run on a schedule. I wish it did, but it's kind of like being a newspaper writer. You have to do it no matter whether you actually feel like you've got a good one or not. You've got to, the task is in front of you, but it has forced at least my staff to do things a lot sooner. Monday you have to go to work because things happen. And also I don't know the technology very well. So I have to struggle a bit with the technology to make sure my upload times are taking a lot longer. When I go through my YouTube, it used to be like 12 minutes, I could load something fairly large. Now it's 25 or 30 minutes.
Well, I'm going to mute everyone and then we will have a time to begin. Well, I am Reverend Gary Rarick, pastor of Epler's UCC in Leesport, Pennsylvania, and I want to welcome you all here this afternoon. Over the next 3 hours, we will be walking with Jesus through his journey to the cross. I want to thank all of the pastors participating this afternoon as we hear this story through meditation, song, and scripture. I ask that all participants remain muted, and I would also like everyone to know that this is being recorded. It is truly an honor to be in worship with so many people from many different congregations and church leaders. It is also a blessing to see the gifts of so many clergy from around the area. May you all find comfort and support during this time, and may we all come together for a time of worship this afternoon. I'm going to begin by reading from John chapter 18, verses 1 through 12. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who was betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. I'm going to just give a brief message this morning. My NRSV Bible that I just read from is one of those Bibles that has the red letters when Jesus speaks. The prior four chapters of John are almost entirely red because Jesus is telling so much that we and his disciples need to know before he goes to the cross. Some of those passages, Jesus is speaking to those disciples and almost directly telling them that he will not be with them much longer. But the disciples don't get it. They are following their leader and continue to celebrate this Passover feast with him. They all go for a walk to the garden. And as they are entering this garden, an army is on their way, being led by Judas to arrest Jesus and take him away. And if we look at some historical documentation, we can determine that it really was an army that came to find Jesus. It was in these moments that we can realize some things about that man. First is that Jesus showed his courage. One of his disciples slices off the ear of one of the soldiers, but Jesus stands there, ready to be taken. Jesus doesn't try to run. He doesn't try to fight. He just stands there and lets it all happen around him. If we were to only have this much courage when we are facing our tough battles, if we could only stand our ground as solidly as Jesus does when it comes to questions of faith, Jesus doesn't back down. The way that Jesus responds also shows us Jesus' protective love. He didn't think about himself as he responded by saying, "Here I am, when the soldiers asked for him. The love that Jesus has for his disciples here is immediate. The love that Jesus has for us is ongoing. This first part of this passion narrative shows us the evil that can be in the world. Judas's betrayal is a story of evil, a story of greed, a story of hate, and a story that we know that we can be called out as people who will also betray God and a people who will be and are sinful. But there is grace. But that, unfortunately, doesn't come for a few more days. I have seen a Facebook post over the past few weeks that said, I planned on giving up things for Lent, but I didn't think I was going to have to give up so much. We have all given up a lot over these past few weeks. We have given up time spent with our extended family and friends. We have given up time with our church family, and our pastors are doing ministry from far away. Jesus did his ministry far away as well, but he also did it intimately close. But Jesus didn't run away. The protective love that Jesus had for his disciples and the courage that Jesus had to stand firm and say, "Here I am," gives us hope that we can be courageous and loving too. Now, Jesus's love didn't stop, and our love should not stop. As multiple pastors from many different churches come together today to share their gifts and the continuing message of Jesus's love through his arrest, his torture, and his death, it is evident of our church communities that even in the midst of our worldwide crisis, the church families recognize the importance of worship and togetherness during this time. The continuation of love will be seen as we move through our afternoon by many different pastors. And my prayer is that we will all be changed by it. Amen. Let me lead us in a time of prayer this morning. Let us pray. O Holy One, we come to you this morning, recognizing the suffering of your Son. We come with our own ideas about what this story means for us. We come with our own challenges and how we are to move forward. We ask, O God, that you will always remind us of your presence, whether we are hearing this story of your Son's death, or when we get to celebrate the Easter resurrection on Sunday. We are grateful for your continued spirit and guidance. And we ask that as we move through this story together, that we will be moved and that we will recognize your grace throughout it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm going to read from John 18, verses 13 to 28. First, they took Jesus to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" Peter said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of the disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Peter reminds me of myself. Impulsive. Compulsive, speaking before we think. Peter fascinates me more than any of the disciples, except maybe John. Follow me as we take a journey through Peter's life as a disciple of our Savior. I'm starting with a quote from Paul, "For I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate." The Apostle Paul said this in Romans 7. It may as well have been Peter. Peter, always speaking quickly and dramatically. Peter, always wanting to be the best. Always thinking after he put his foot in his mouth. Peter, first known as Simon. When Jesus insisted that the fishermen cast their nets again, the nets came up heavy indeed. When Simon saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." This is the calling of Simon the fisherman to change from catching fish to catching people. And the naming of Simon, this is the Simon, son of John, whom Jesus named Cephas, which means Peter. And then there was the walking on the water and the night of a huge storm. The disciples were in a boat and Jesus walked to them on the water. Peter said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Jesus said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But Peter became frightened and began to sink. Peter cried out, saying, "Lord, save me." The Lord reached his hand to Peter, saying, "O ye of little faith." And Peter the rock. When Jesus said to the disciples, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And then in Matthew, Jesus addressing Peter, and I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. And Peter, the holder of the keys, Jesus still speaking, says, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. Hence, Peter, the gatekeeper to heaven and the source of many cartoons. And the flesh and the blood. After Jesus addressed the crowds about the bread being his own flesh, many disciples left, but the 12 stayed, with Simon Peter saying these words, Lord, there is no one else that we can go to. Your words give eternal life. We have faith in you, and we are sure that you are God's Holy One. And when Jesus had the talk with his disciples about his future, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you. But Jesus turned and said to Peter, Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. And then the transfiguration. This Peter was one of the three disciples invited to witness the transfiguration of Jesus along with John and James. Jesus led them up on the mountain to pray. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but they managed to stay awake and witness the transformation of Jesus in all his shining glory. They did not miss Moses and Elijah's appearance together with Jesus. Just as Moses and Elijah were leaving Jesus, Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah, not knowing what he said. Immediately comes the affirmation from the Father that Jesus is his beloved Son, and we shall listen to his Son. A chance to listen to Jesus comes when Jesus starts to wash the feet of the disciples during the gathering in the upper room on that memorable night when later the soldiers came to take Jesus. When Jesus comes to Simon Peter, we hear Simon Peter say, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? You will never wash my feet. Jesus answered, Unless I wash you, you have no share with me. Simon Peter said to Jesus, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. And Jesus tells Peter's denial. As the dialogue goes on, Peter says, Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for you. Jesus answered, Will you lay down your life for me? Very truly, I tell you, before the cock crows, you will have denied me three times. And Jesus said to the disciples, You will all become deserters, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee. After the gathering in the upper room, Jesus takes with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John, to the Garden of Gethsemane. And Jesus began to be grieved and agitated. And he went to the disciples and finds them sleeping. And he says to Peter, so could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? And we heard Pastor Gary read the story of Peter cutting off one of the people, the soldier's ear. And also, after they take Jesus to his trial, a woman at the gate says to Peter, you are not also one of this man's disciples, are you? I am not. And the slaves gathered around the cold fire. And one of them says, you are one of the disciples, are you? And Peter says, I am not. And again, a slave, one of the relatives of the man whose ear Peter cut off, said, did I not see you in the garden with him? Again, Peter denies it. And at that moment, the cock crows. And Mark 14 says, Peter broke down and weeps. Then there was this wonderful seashore experience. After the resurrection, again, Jesus tells the disciples to try again with this fishing goal. A large amount of fish come into the net. So Simon Peter goes aboard and hauls the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there are so many, the net is not torn. Jesus has the grill ready. And Jesus, the risen Lord, and his disciples share breakfast on the beach. When they finish breakfast, Jesus says to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Peter says to Jesus, yes, Lord. You know that I love you. Jesus says to Peter, feed my lambs. A second time, Jesus says to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter says to Jesus, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus says, tend my sheep. Jesus says to Simon Peter the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter feels hurt because Jesus says to him the third time, do you love me? And Peter says to Jesus, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus says to him, feed my sheep. Three times Peter had denied Jesus before Jesus died. But three times does Jesus offer an opportunity to erase the denials, to express love, and to show love. Lord, we pray that of all the times that we deny you, you give us the chance to prove that, yes, we do, to balance it out. And when we look back at our lives, as Peter must have looked back at his, that we remember the times when we have been glad to admit that we belong to you, that we are one of the lambs, one of the sheep, and that someone is caring for us, and we are caring for other sheep and other lambs. We care for each other. This is what your love is all about. It's not that love just comes from you and stops with us. No, that is not the way we do it. This is not the way you design things. We have to pass your love. And we say, Christians, we will know, people will know that we are Christians because of our love. And when we look back on each day, have we shown that? Have we looked like Christians? Oh, Lord, we need your help. We need your help each and every day. Help us not to be the compulsive Peter and say things that hurt other people accidentally, and later we have to ask your forgiveness. But you look at us and say, child, I do love you. I do love you. You're one of my precious children. Come to me. Come to me. Even though your faith is little, come to me and your faith will grow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello. Guess I could start now. I've been unmuted by the host. I'm Dave Blitch. I'm here at my home in my dining room this morning. Normally, I do these Zoom meetings in the deck right behind me. Be out in nature and get a little fresh air. But, you know, today it's pretty windy and it's pretty cold. So I decided to not go outside and do this here in my dining room. Just putting my watch out here so I can monitor my time too. Because I have 15 minutes and we'll see how I do with that. I'm not the best person at guessing how long I'm gonna speak, but we'll work it out somehow. I gotta say that when I was 11 years old, the Jesus Christ Superstar album came out. That was one of the first albums that I bought, first on cassette, and then later on CD. And I had a pretty cool pastor, and he took us, our confirmation class, to see the original Broadway musical. Rock opera, Jesus Christ Superstar. So we went to Broadway and saw it. I could still sing the whole darn thing. I basically memorized the entire dialogue, all of the singing in Jesus Christ Superstar. And that drives my wife Karen nuts, because if we're watching some kind of a video, you know, presentation on the TV, I'm singing along, and she kind of wants to hear the people on the TV, not me, which makes sense, of course. But anyway, my first impression of Pontius Pilate and my passage is about Pontius Pilate. My first impression of Pontius Pilate was probably crafted by Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice, who, of course, wrote Jesus Christ Superstar. But I'm going to read the passage now. This is from John. This is John 18, 29 to 32. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." And Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicted or indicated the kind of death he was to die. So yeah, I could sing that trial before Pilate in Jesus Christ Superstar for you, but you don't want to hear me do that. But my take on this, and probably also is affected by Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice, is that the pilot was just doing his job at this point. Pilate was in a bind. Of course, he was a Roman ruler. He was in Israel that was being occupied. And of course, the Israelites, the Jewish people, did not at all appreciate Rome occupying their land. They were the enemy to the Jewish people, the Romans were, and they wanted them out. And that was, of course, what was in the back of their minds when they're looking for a Messiah, someone that would get them freedom from the Romans. But Pilate is just trying to keep the peace. He's trying to calm down the crowd. He's trying to make sure that when all these people are flooding in for the Passover, that they're not going to riot. That he's going to do whatever he needs to do to make sure the crowd's going to chill. So he's going to find the best way, the expedient way, the most convenient way to further his goal. He was doing his job. He didn't really care about Jesus. He really didn't care about the Jewish people all that much. He cared for no one but himself and the Roman rule. And he cared the most about peace, about the famous Pax Romana. So he did what he did. He eventually gave into the crowd and gave into crucifying Jesus just so the crowd would shut up and go home and be quiet. Sometimes doing the right really can be doing the wrong thing. Sometimes just following the status quo or following what we're expected to do or do what is the normal thing is not helpful. Sometimes following the status quo can even be harmful, even it can be toxic. Jesus blew up the status quo. Jesus was saying that, you know, the way that you're worshiping now is wrong. It's not worshiping in the correct way. The way you're following the laws of Moses now, the way you're interpreting them and the way you're implementing them doesn't work. God doesn't want you to live this way. Now, here I am, I'm Jesus. I have this new way. And of course, that upset a lot of people. A lot of people that live by the status quo, that the profession was regulated by the status quo, that keeping it the way it was important to them. Because Jesus said, we have to change it. What you think you should be doing is really not what you should be doing. So we need to not be afraid of doing things in a new way. Because if we do things in a new way, it might actually be God calling us to do it that way, even if it goes against what we've been doing for 1,000 years or 50 years or 5 years or whatever. Sometimes we just have to realize that we got to change it. Change it up, go a different direction. And that's what Jesus was all about. And maybe all this stuff we're doing now, you know, I never heard of Zoom until a few weeks ago, right? It's like, what? That's a Zoom. But I've been doing many of these now. And of course, I've been recording worship services, and that's, you know, totally new too. I mean, I'm not someone who likes to be before a camera, but you know what? I gotta be, so here I am. Hopefully we're doing well. with this social distancing. And we all pray, of course, that sometime in the future, near future, we'll be able to gather again in our sanctuaries and worship together. So here's something that another pastor wrote. I'll do a portion of it, and then we'll go to some prayers, and I'll stretch the prayers out to make up the difference between the time and when I'm supposed to be off at quarter of. This is about Jesus. I saw something the other day that literally made me stop and think. Jesus, revolutionary. It certainly wasn't the first time that I thought about this, as I believe I've written about it before. What made this instant different was in my understanding, or lack thereof, about just how radical Jesus actually was. The reason for a pause had more to do with how we define revolutionary and what that term means as it relates to Christ today. This time, the phrase made me think of revolutionary in terms of my own faith walk. One of the core truths and teaching principles about the life and death of Jesus is that he was all about substance. He could care less about style. I've come to know through Jesus that the outward act of prayer has little, if anything, to do with the internal purpose of prayer. The literal and technical interpretation of God's law has little value if not filtered through the intent of God's will. Jesus was executed because he challenged the rigid practice of the intellectual and literal enforcement of rules and regulations. He simply asked of those in charge, "Where is the love and compassion in what you do?" When you break it down, the revolutionary part becomes apparent when you look at who Jesus helped. The miracles were more about the lame and the lost, the poor and the blind, even the wretched and the vile. Jesus himself didn't fit the mold of whom the church wanted to call king. He wasn't kingly enough by the strict interpretation of the rules and regulations. Christ actually hung out with the wrong crowd, practiced radical religion, and preached threatening sermons. When he talked about forgiveness, that meant being the forgiver rather than the forgiven. Paul spoke the power without fear. Christ's revolutionary example gave him the courage to do so. The love Jesus spoke about is the love you give, not the love you expect to receive. The same held true for mercy and charity. I guess this really was enough to get him killed. The ironic part of my point is if you only preach these principles, nothing will happen to you. But if you actually practice these truths, you too might fall prey to gossip and jealousy, envy, and maybe even death. I guess you know if you're a revolutionary, if people see you challenging the status quo in order to do God's will. Is anybody paying attention to you these days? Remember, it's all about doing things in the name of the Lord for his purpose. May God bless and give you the strength to be his revolutionary today in the church of your choosing. So let us pray. I'll pause between each of these portions of the prayer so we can have some time to reflect. We pray for the church throughout the world, especially those on the front lines of the healing, the front lines in our hospitals, nurses, EMTs, other first responders, all those who are in essential businesses and have to have contact with the people. We pray for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who hold public office, especially those for wisdom and foresight in these troubled times, the decisions made in our government offices, in both locally and nationally, may be for the betterment of our society and for the elimination of our virus. So bring wisdom to them, Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all those in need, especially the sick, and those left devastated physically, spiritually, mentally, financially, and socially by COVID-19. My wife's friend just lost their son to COVID. So we pray for Sally and all who mourn the loss of her son. Lord, in your mercy. For those who are confused and anxious in these times, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who question their faith, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now let us pray together the words of the Lord's Prayer. I do shared ministry, so we use the word sin and sinners when it comes to that part of the prayer. So I'll be using that. So let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you for listening.
Okay, hi. I was trying to unmute myself. So I'm Pastor Linda. I serve at Good Shepherd UCC Tuckerton, and I'm grateful for this space to be together on this holiest of days. And I again invite us to enter a time of prayer. Beloved, on this day of shadows, on this day of sorrows, let us join our hearts together in the spirit of prayer. Holy Jesus, as we walk with you with this day, our hearts break open. We listen for your love. We search ourselves and our broken spaces. We remember how you asked us to stay with you in the garden, how you asked us to serve our neighbors and to love as you have loved us. As we continue to journey with you this day, may we deeply enter your story. May we deeply reflect on your message. May we hear how you call us to continue to follow, to listen for your truth. And we lift this prayer in your holy name. Amen. So my reading today is from the Gospel of John in the 18th chapter, verses 33 through 40. And I'm going to invite you to experience this passage using the ancient practice of Lectio Divina. So we'll hear this passage three times, and I'm going to use different translations. I'm going to use the New Revised Standard Version, the Common English Bible, and the Message. And in between readings, we'll have time to pause, time to reflect on what we hear, to ponder how God is speaking to us, and to think about how God may be inviting us to go a little deeper into today's narrative. So if you have paper and pen handy, perhaps you want to jot down your thoughts. write down what speaks to you, how it might connect with what you've been in feeling and experiencing in this time of uncertainty, this time when we truly are wandering in the wilderness. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" And Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born. And for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is the truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him. But you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the King of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. So I'm going to invite you to pause for a few minutes. Think about what you hear, what touched your heart, what touched your soul. Pilate went back into the palace. He summoned Jesus and asked, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this on your own, or have others spoken to you about me?" Pilate responded, "I'm not a Jew, am I? Your nation and its chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus replied, "My kingdom doesn't originate from this world. If it did, my guards would fight so that I wouldn't have been arrested by the Jewish leaders. My kingdom isn't from here." "So you are a king," Pilate said. Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. I was born and came into the world for this reason, to testify to the truth. Whoever accepts the truth listens to my voice." "What is the truth?" Pilate asked. After Pilate said this, he returned to the Jewish leaders and said, I find no grounds for any charges against him. You have a custom that I release one prisoner for you at Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews? They shouted, "Not this man. Give us Barabbas." Barabbas was an outlaw. As you pause for a few more moments, did you hear or feel something different in this second reading? Did you perhaps hear or feel something that invited you to go deeper, deeper into your faith or deeper into this reflection? Pilate went back into the palace and called for Jesus. He said, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Are you saying this on your own, or did others tell you this about me?" Pilate said, "Do I look like a Jew? Your people and your high priest turned you over to me. What did you do?" "My kingdom," said Jesus, "doesn't consist of what you see around you. If it did, my followers would fight so that I wouldn't be handed over to the Jews. But I'm not that kind of king, not the world's kind of king." Then Pilate said, "So are you a king or not?" Jesus answered, "You tell me. Because I am king, I was born and entered the world so I could witness to the truth. Everyone who cares for the truth, who has any feeling for the truth, recognizes my voice." Pilate said, "What is the truth?" Then he went back out to the Jews and told them, "I find nothing wrong with this man. It's your custom that I pardon one prisoner at Passover. Do you want me to pardon the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Not this one, but Barabbas." Barabbas was a Jewish freedom fighter. Friends, I invite you to continue to reflect on the words, the feelings, the gentle whispers, or the tender nudges which came to you as we heard this passage. And I invite you to continue to reflect as we go deeper this day into the story of Jesus's passion. As we gather together in this time of deep anxiety and deep uncertainty, and may you remember that our Creator is always offering you steadfast and eternal love. May you remember that Jesus is still offering that deep and abiding peace. May you remember the Spirit is still surrounding you with comfort and compassion. So let us be in prayer as we end this segment, and I offer a breath prayer. Beloved, breathe in the truth that Jesus came to share with the world. And as you exhale, release what you are no longer able to carry or what you no longer need to carry. Breathe in the love that Jesus reveals. Love which was willing to walk the journey of this day. And exhale any anger or bitterness that you may have been feeling or holding on to. And breathe in the hope that God offers to us even in the midst of despair, even in the midst of this virus, as we shelter in place. And release any feelings of hopelessness that you may have been experiencing that may have been overwhelming you. And breathe in the presence of Jesus. As we continue to enter into this narrative and release any feelings that you are alone, because Jesus is with you. May this day be meaningful. May this day offer new perspectives. May this day bring you closer to Jesus and deeper in your faith. Amen. And blessings to each of you.
Greetings, friends.
Hello.
Let us continue this story. We'll be reading from John chapter 19, verses 1 through 3. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it upon his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. And they kept coming up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Friends, I wonder if you would join us in a brief song. I'm going to do my best via technology. Yes. This hymn, "O Sacred Head Now Wounded," is a very, very old hymn taken from a very, very old poem and an even older melody, recorded a couple of weeks ago at Trinity Reformed United Church of Christ in Pottstown. And I have to warn you that he starts almost immediately with no introduction. So make sure you're muted and let's sing along. Thank you. I sure hope that worked. So that hymn, like many of our sacred hymns, was not always so sacred. That melody that we all know so well actually came from a 16th century, I don't know if you'd call it a love song. It's very emotional and sad and dramatic, and it reads a little bit like a combination of like All Shook Up and The Journal of a 13-year-old boy. My mind's confused within me, made thus by a tender maiden. I am utterly astray. My heart hurts badly. I have no rest day and night. I ever lament. I keep sighing and crying and almost despairing. Oh, that she would ask me what was the cause of my complaint. I would tell her freely that she alone is the thing that wounds me so much. Could I soften her heart? Oh, then I'd be better soon. 10 verses like that of a seemingly sad teenage boy lamenting over a young woman who is the fairest and most beautiful and most wonderful, who does not return his love. And it seems oddly appropriate that that would be the music that Bach and later others, even Paul Simon, would borrow and use, because though we don't always talk about the story of Jesus and his passion and his coming as a story of love and heartbreak, it absolutely is. In John 1, we read that the Word became flesh, the Word that had created the world became flesh and lived among us to save us, and we didn't recognize him. And what tender love is it that would make one give up so much and become so vulnerable and so weak and come open-armed, ready to be accepted and to help and to be loved, but only to be rejected and beaten and mocked, and not only rejected, but to have a false crown put on and a purple robe, which must have already been junk from something else, because that would have been very expensive otherwise. And to be mocked like that, and we think about Jesus's physical pain, especially with the crown of thorns and the beating and all of that, but the emotional pain, the heartbreak, the longing, the unrequited love that must have been gnawing away at him as well, perhaps just as much.
Grief is this horrible monster. It's not something that we can endure and be done. It's not something that we can measure. It's not something that we can finish. And I think about the times my heart has been broken. I think about, you know, romantic love relationships and how when those come to an end and when we say goodbye and when we let go of one another, it seems like my heart is breaking. It seems like I wish you could just slap me, because after the slap was over, then I could move on. But that's not grief. That's not how it works. I think about when I was a little girl, I'd get in trouble and I'd maybe get a spanking or sent to my room. And I was almost grateful for that, because my dad had this way of saying, "I'm really disappointed in you." And that broke my heart. That stayed with me. That was what I couldn't let go of. The time in my room, the spanking, those physical things were so much easier to get over, but my dad being disappointed in me, I couldn't bear that. And so I think of this time in the story where Jesus has this crown of thorns on, where he's being mocked. And I feel like it might have been a reprieve from the betrayal by one of his best friends. The denial of his Peter three times when Jesus needed him the most, when Jesus needed him to know him. The physical torture, the pain, that's what we're talking about, but it's so much more. Physical pain. Maybe he's going over the details of last night. Maybe he's trying to remember the good times, like when they ate bread, drank wine. Physical torture. You can't think of anything else. And so in this time of excruciating pain, of mockery, because he chose to do that. He chose to love, he chose to go there. No one could make him do that.
So let's take a moment. In the few moments that we have left, and just 1 minute, think about that connection that you feel to your own experience. I know it's, my therapist would tell me not to dwell on the negative experiences in my life, and normally I would discourage that. But in this small container, this 1 to 2 minutes, just take a minute. And I want you to think about that moment where you felt betrayed, where you felt alone, where you felt like you had put yourself out there and made yourself vulnerable and instead seemingly lost. And we'll get to the redemption next, but I want to sit there for just a minute. And I wonder where your mind went. Silence is a dangerous thing, is it not? Did you immediately go to romantic love, like the writer of that 16th century sad love song? Did you go to a professional moment where you were made to look foolish in front of your peers and those that you respect? Was it something that had happened in church, right, or in your family, those that are closest to you? Friends, one of the beautiful and wonderful things about the story of today, of Good Friday, one of the reasons it's a Good Friday and not truly a Friday of horrors, is what we know is coming in 2 days. And so we know that the God that we pray to every other day of the year knows exactly what that feels like, understands 100%, more than any of us could ever imagine, understands that feeling of being vulnerable and then losing it, being taken advantage of. And so take some comfort in knowing that Christ suffers along with you in that, and isn't rushing you to get over it. you know, we may need to sit in a grave for a couple of days first before we reach that new life, but it is coming, and it has been promised, and it has been shown. So would you like to lead us in prayer?
Let us pray. Oh God, we know that you, that suffering, that grief, that pain is not foreign to you. That you came as a man, as a human, as someone who experienced pain on all levels. And God, as we sit in this pain with you and we don't try to flee, we don't try to drink it away, to eat it away, to escape, be in this with us as we're in it with you. Give us the patience and the courage to stay. And we adore you, we love you, and we're so sorry. Amen.
Amen.
Greetings, friends, and welcome to this community sharing of the Holy Week services. I'm Reverend Dan Clark, interim pastor of the St. John's Haines United Church of Christ in Warnersville, PA. And I want to say on behalf of our members, I send you greetings of peace to all of our Christian sisters and brothers during this special time of the year. We, like all of you, are sheltering in place, and we're learning to use other methods of staying in contact with each other, and holding our meetings and even our worshiping in different styles than any of us could have ever imagined. We're all learning how to do this in a very different ways. Each day is a new adventure for us, a new way of learning, and we have discovered that in many times it's not just a curve, it's an absolute vertical wall. So we are climbing the wall. Hopefully we'll get over the top and learn to use this technology, which has become so commonplace and necessary in our culture, but not so much in our church life. I must admit to you, it often feels odd to use this technology in our church life, but we are learning to adjust and find God even through the internet. I recall my own church camp experiences where we once had communion with Coca-Cola and potato chips. When I told my parents about it, they were aghast that we would use such, in their eyes, a demeaning symbol of the communion. But hey, we thought it was great, right on target, because it used the symbols of our everyday life. I've discovered that the United Church of Christ folks are often quick to use the phrase, God is still speaking. But now I think they need to add, including the internet. So today we take up the symbols of our culture, the use of computers and internet, unheard of only 25 years ago, but now an essential part of our daily lives to share together in the central part of the Christian story, the last week of Jesus's life on earth. This brings in our Holy Week journey to Good Friday, a strange name for a day when Jesus was dehumanized before his own people and family, where he was tried unjustly, where he was beaten and tortured and ultimately murdered through the ignominy of crucifixion. In German, the term is translated as Sorrowful Friday, which I believe to most Christians, certainly to me, is much more descriptive. But the word good remains as a symbol of not only Jesus' suffering, but also because it was the closing curtain of his life, only to reopen to a glorious resurrection. So today, we read a selection from John's description of this day. We are reminded again in these words of the depth of human ignorance, fear, and chaos but also the light of God's revelation, bringing salvation, truth, justice, and mercy. The scripture passage for this part of our community celebration is John 19:4-7. It reads as follows. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I'm bringing him out to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God." "We have a law," the Jews shouted at Pilate in their argument for him to be crucified. Pilate, we must remember, could not ignore this response, as his primary purpose for being in Palestine was to uphold Roman law to keep the peace. While there were obviously other functions he ensured should take place, it was primarily to keep the peace. And failure to do this, he knew, could result in his own removal, even death. In spite of all the good roads he'd created, and the public buildings he erected, and the water supply he protected, keeping the peace, the law, was important. He cared little for Jewish religious law, but he knew he could not ignore the law of Rome, which asked for peace at any cost. But the encounter with Jesus and Pilate earlier in the discussion about truth revealed that Pilate also knew the law could be used in ways which rationalized and supported behaviors which were only to protect self-interests of individuals and groups. These laws had no public interest in mind. They were used to keep the public at bay, to serve as a force for public fear of reprisals. In fact, most of the laws promulgated were just that: fig leaves to cover and justify the seizing of land, subscription into slavery like work for the government, and to protect the cash flow needed to run Rome's expensive presence in Palestine. To respond to the Jews' request of punishment for Jesus was not based on any benefit to improvement or protection of Jewish life, but to the continuance of a theocratic government full of greed, power consumption, and a continued entrenchment of an institution, the temple, which was itself a source of money and power and corruption. We all know about these kinds of laws in our country. We went through decades of civil rights marches and legislation because a collection of laws known commonly as Jim Crow were used to subjugate an entire race. Black folks were constantly kept essentially imprisoned by the use of these laws. In those early days, every action to control those who spoke for racial justice was met by violence, and it was often rationalized on the basis, "Well, we have a law." Where people ate and sat and drank was controlled under the rubric, "We have a law for that too." "Sit at the back of the bus," the sign said, in the buses of my hometown in Knoxville, Tennessee. We know the Nazis used this to justify the seizing of the property and even the imprisonment and murdering of Jews because they had a law. In India today, an entire religious culture is being threatened by the leaders of another religion on the basis of, "We now have a law." The unfortunate truth is that the law has been historically not only a needed protection for order in our civilization, but has also been used as a way to support injustice, violence against others, and the use of government for personal gain and power. "We have a law," shouted the Jews to Pilate, for they knew he understood this would serve as a narrative to avoid any responsibility for their acts or to allow any voice of criticism to be leveled against the temple. Jesus was not ignorant. Jesus knew the law. He quoted it frequently in his teachings. But he also knew another law, You have heard it said, but I say unto you, was his standard opening line to a new law, not one of paper and politics, but one of the human heart and human will. In Matthew, it is recorded Jesus made this clear when he stated, you have heard that it has been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you that you resist not evil, but whoever shall hit you on your right cheek, turn to him the other one also. This was the new law. It could not be legislated. It could only occur when there was a redemption of heart and mind and will. Those who followed Martin Luther King Jr. discovered to be a part of his movement was not a political decision, but a spiritual and faith one. Jesus calls us beyond the law to what is first stated not by him, but in the ancient book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6, verse 5, that we are to love with all of our heart, our mind, and our strength. And then Jesus added the new part, and your neighbor as yourself. Yes, Jesus knew the law, the Jews shouted, could not be changed at the moment. His response to them did not make the change by revealing the law could not control the human heart. It could not control the human will. Even human action, when it is centered, is a God who loves us, a God who asks us to love God in return, and all other parts of God's creation. I believe Jesus knew the kingdom he sought to bring could not be ruled by an earthly crown, but only by a God who transforms all human passions, all human needs and wants and desires into a force for peace, for justice, and for mercy. He knew he could not stop the inevitability of what was occurring to him and around him. But he also knew that his resurrection would be the power which moved beyond inevitability to possibility. I think there is not a single Christian who doesn't have their heart broken when they read this painful narrative about Jesus. But let us also affirm as Christians that our spirits are not broken. Why? Because they do not reside only with Good Friday, but with Easter morning. There the voices are not about the law, but the eternal power of God, which stretches beyond all human barriers, even into eternal life. The crowds of Jesus had their day, but at the end, their real day is just dawning. And Easter morning, the one we will see very soon, its sunrise will fill us with new hope. It will give us a new spirit, and it promises a new awareness that the kingdom of God is truly within us. Let us pray. O God, we pray that you would receive the stories of Jesus' torture and death, but also look beyond to the promise of resurrection, which transforms all evil, breaks all laws which promote injustice, and offers to all creation your saving power and redemption. And now may God give us peace in our minds, in our hearts, and in our homes. May God's blessing stretch before us in an endless horizon of grace. May God's word be your comfort, your strength, and your guide, now and forever. Christ is risen. Christ is risen, indeed. Amen. And now I offer this brief music demonstrating my lack of technological sophistication. A few bars from He Never Said a Mumbling Word.
Wasn't it a pity and a shame, and he never said a mumbling word. Thank you, Dan. I just wanted to say a word about how these selections were chosen for us, and actually they weren't when Gary sent out the invitation to be a part of this community service. He invited us to select one of the sections to read. And so the section that I chose is this. Now, when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." Well, God played a joke on me. I chose these particular verses from the Good Friday story because I was sure I knew what they meant for us today. I can hear God laughing even now as I try to give words to what she is saying to us. Pride goes before the fall. So please pray with me. God, may the thoughts of my heart and the words of my mouth be what you want said today. Help me be humble enough to hear your still speaking voice. And may those who listen find your message in spite of me. Amen. According to New Testament scholar Mark Allen Powell, John's gospel is the only one of the four to identify Jesus as God. But in this text, he clearly shows that Jesus is completely human as well. In the five verses we just heard, Jesus is at the mercy of both Pilate and the crowd. He performs no miracle, nor does he call on God to save himself from being judged and sentenced. Trials make good entertainment for many people. I've always enjoyed television shows in which a person is found guilty by a jury for a crime that we know he or she committed. We know this because we saw it happen earlier in the episode. Or, on the other hand, an innocent person is exonerated and justice is again served. Both of those outcomes occur in shows like Perry Mason, As I Show My Age, or more recently, All Rise, Love City Law, Bull, and the many incarnations of Law and Order. But in all the trials dramatized in these shows, there is a burden of proof required. And the judge doesn't often have the final word. Instead, the accused faces a jury of his or her peers. In this gospel story, though, there seems to be a judge, Pilate, but no jury, unless we consider the mob to be the jury. It's Pilate who has the legal power to make the final determination of Jesus' fate, but he is afraid. what? Is it the fact that Jesus is silent, not showing any fear of what Pilate can do to harm him? People who wield power often rely on fear to enable that power to be used. Perhaps it's that Pilate realizes that Jesus' next words are true. You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Hearing this, Pilate might wonder if the power that has been given him by the emperor is really not enough. He faces his own weakness in this unusual situation, where people are calling for the death of one of their own. Power is a dangerous thing. It rarely brings out the best in a person, and it often brings out the worst. The mob shouting for Jesus' death challenged Pilate's power. He knew Jesus was not guilty of any crime that deserved crucifixion. But the mob clamored on, maybe sensing Pilate's weakness, telling him that Jesus claimed to be a king, and therefore threatened both the rule of the Roman emperor and Pilate's job of enforcing that rule. The people in that mob lived under the rule of Rome. But here they were, influencing Pilate's decision, perhaps even usurping the power he thought was his. And for what? Maybe they too were afraid. Afraid of Jesus, frightened by what they had seen him doing and heard him saying over the 3 years of his ministry. Were Jesus' preaching and actions turning their world upside down, disempowering their religious leaders? Well, it's easy to condemn Pilate and the mob for Jesus' death. Some Christians sadly still blame the Jews for killing Jesus. The son of someone I know came home from religion class upset because he had a Jewish friend, wanting to know if his friend had really killed Jesus. But let's be honest. We are sometimes part of the mob today, condemning people unjustly. We use our voices to condemn people because of the color of their skin. I recently read a post by an African-American man who is worried about what might happen if he wears a mask during this pandemic, as we're being asked to do. Will walking into a market while wearing a mask put him in danger because of his skin color? Will he be seen differently than a white person wearing a mask? He has, unfortunately, a valid concern. We use our voices to condemn some people because of their ethnicity. Asian Americans have been targeted recently for violence because they are being blamed for the existence of the coronavirus that just happened to originate in China. If the virus had originated here, who would we find to be the scapegoat? We use our voices to condemn some people because of their faith. In addition to those targeted because they are Jewish, we all know how many of our Muslim sisters and brothers have been demonized because of the radicalism of a relative few. Unfortunately, there has been mob violence in our past, lynching of people of color, mob violence, and attacks against immigrants, LGBTQ persons, and the list goes on. Political finger pointing can also be a form of condemnation if we're not careful. So the question I want to raise for us right now is this. How are we behaving in this current climate of fear? Fear of the coronavirus and how it upsets our lives. Fear for the health of our families and friends. Fear for the safety of those who work on the front lines of medicine. For those who continue to work at jobs that are necessary for our survival. Fear for our livelihoods and the ability to support our families. Maybe, like Pilate, we are fearful mostly because we realize how powerless we really are, and we react out of our powerlessness. We all know what we must do. All those things that the CDC advises for our own safety and the safety of others. But then we hear the voices of the mob, those who can't or won't admit that we are powerless right now. Those voices come to us through news shows, briefings, Facebook, Instagram, and probably a lot of other electronic communications that I have no clue about, and also from ourselves. The shout out for us to get back to our normal. We miss our sports teams, gatherings, going out to eat, classrooms even, family members, social groups, church gatherings. This is not the way life is supposed to be. We don't want to continue on this difficult journey. We don't like being powerless, and we don't like feeling afraid. We're invited many times throughout both the Old and the New Testaments that we should not fear. So I invite you to listen now to these words in the lyrics of Be Not Afraid, sung by John Michael Talbot.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far and safe, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live. Kingdom.
Let us pray. Jesus, what a terrible injustice to see you condemned to death. Your own people, the Roman judge and the soldiers, didn't recognize that you were the Son of God. Give us the grace to see, respect, and love you in all people, both innocent and guilty. Change our hearts that we may see with new eyes those we might otherwise condemn because of our fear. Let us take to heart your message, be not afraid, whenever we fear our powerlessness. Amen.
Good afternoon. I am Pastor Glenn Rarick, pastor of Faith Reformed United Church of Christ in Landingville. I'd like to read the Gospel of John, chapter 19, verses 13 through 16a. When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the stone pavement. It was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about noon. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews, but they shouted, "Take him away, take him away, crucify him." "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priest answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. May God add his blessing upon the reading, the hearing, and the interpretation of this, his holy word. Let us pray. O God of infinite love and power, we gather together on this Good Friday to reflect on the passion of Christ. We are utterly humbled in the presence of such love and mercy. Open our hearts this day to the goodness of Good Friday, and fill us with your love and powerful spirit of holiness. Remove from us all sin and offer us again this life in Christ that makes all things new. Amen. From our reading today, we had heard that they just arrested Jesus and brought him to Pilate. Pilate, who wanted nothing to do with this traveling preacher. Yet politics being what they were, Pilate found himself backed into a corner, and he felt compelled to act on the mob's demands. "Away with him," they yelled. "Away with him, crucify him." "Crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the leading priest shouted back. Now, this was an incident that occurred some 2,000 years ago. And it is all about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And the leading priests shout, "We have no king but Caesar." And never would a Jew say such a thing with greater freedom and, more importantly, with greater arrogance. But you must understand that Jews are not known to be proud of their race, and for good reason. They would never normally and willingly accept a non-Jew to rule over them. And for them to acknowledge Caesar as king is as strange to say at the least. But something is wrong here. They were rejecting Jesus, the promised Messiah. And not only were they rejecting him, but they asked for him to be crucified. Now, a Jew being given up to Roman death by this detestable Roman method, the most shameful death, the most gruesome death, the most painful death. In fact, the term excruciating could be taken from the pain of him dying on the cross. Now, a Jew would never willingly have another Jew crucified. But here they do as a sign of rejection. And as we look at this story, we find that there were some terrible mistakes made on that day. Misjudgments that would have far-reaching implications. Now, mistakes come in all different shapes and sizes. Some are small and have little long-term impact, while other mistakes can have enormous implications. They're like when we throw a stone into a tranquil pond, and the ripples can be seen from that point of impact. Now, the first mistake that they made was thinking that Pilate was their real judge. See, as Pilate sat on the bench preparing to announce his decision, he saw only the short term. He thought that he was the only judge on that stone platform that day, but he was tragically wrong. The one who would someday judge all humanity, including Pilate, stood next to them that day, but Pilate couldn't see it. And it was easy to judge reality on the basis of what we see around us. And all Pilate saw was the Roman soldiers with their weapons, answering to him, and he thought that he had the real power. But what he didn't realize was what true power really is. So will you make that same mistake? Will you evaluate your life using the wrong criteria and miss out on the truth of God's presence? And the second mistake that they made was they were overlooking the real preparation of the day. It was the day of preparation of the Passover, a day when they would celebrate God's deliverance of his people from Egypt. And it was an important religious ceremony, a time to worship God. But yet they foolishly overlooked the very Son of God, one who was standing in their presence, the one who would truly prepare them to encounter the holy and the true God. See, sometimes we all make mistakes. We get caught up in religion that we lose the contact with our deeper reality of faith. So will you make that mistake? Will you allow your attention to be diverted by ceremony and other external factors and miss out on the true reality of God's presence with us? And the third mistake that they made was ignoring the real king. The world looked to Caesar as their ultimate political power. I mean, Pilate did. Power was delegated by the emperor. The Sanhedrin did, for they knew that their protected status depended on appeasing attitude with the Roman authorities. And the mob did, for they declared, "We have no king but the emperor." They simply didn't realize that the one who stood before them was their true king, the king and king and lord of lords, and the one who was about to be crucified was the one who will reign over all creation. Pilate didn't realize how true his words were when he asked the mob, "Shall I crucify your king?" The tragedy was that they ignored their true king. So will you make that same mistake, placing your loyalty and your allegiance in the wrong ruler? Will you miss out on the true king who seeks a place in your heart? Now, mistakes are only permanent when we refuse to correct them. So don't make the mistake of failing to recognize Jesus for the one that he truly is. And don't fail to surrender your heart and your life to the one true King. Now, the events of Good Friday some 2,000 years ago speak of evil, tragedy, and sorrow. Now Jesus is arrested on some trumped up charges and he's hauled off to be executed by a long, painful, and humiliating way. And the question was asked that day that we still ask today, why? Why did this happen? Why did God allow it? And why didn't he stop it? And even Jesus asked the question, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Now, Good Friday doesn't allow us for easy answers. To face the cross is one of our worst fears. Fears that our life is meaningless, full of failure, suffering, and death. But if Good Friday were all about where we are, then as Christians, we would be the most depressing people on this earth. But we know that Good Friday is not the whole story. We know that there is a resurrection on Sunday. It is the day of victory. And as we look towards Easter, let us continue to think about that last line that I read in our reading this morning. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Good Friday is the day that we remember the crucifixion of Jesus. But there's more to it than just remembering. We want to embrace the resurrection, but Jesus calls us to the cross, to the point of the story is that Friday is the road that leads to Sunday. There's no Easter Sunday without Good Friday, and there's no resurrection without the cross. Good Friday gives us the opportunity to proclaim that once we've been to the cross, everything changes. Stumbling blocks of foolishness turn into power and wisdom, and the cross changes everything for us. Now, Jesus predicted his death and resurrection. And it's one thing to predict the future, but it's quite another to go to the cross willingly. Now, Jesus shared his destiny with his disciples, but they didn't understand. And more challenging still is the fact that Jesus embraced his destiny by faith. He knew that the Father's promise of resurrection, but he knew that death was still before him. But it was his trust in his Father's promise that caused him to wager everything he had, to give up his very life. So I ask you to put your faith in Jesus, to take time today to reflect on the events of Good Friday, but also to remember that he will rise again for you and for me on Sunday morning. Amen.
Good afternoon. It's good to be here with all of you in the way in which we're gathering. I'm Frances Chester. I'm pastor at Falkner Swamp in Gilbertsville. So as we move further into John's gospel, the time has come for Jesus to be put to death. Before we go there, let's just for a moment acknowledge again, as I'm sure others have before me, the particular and peculiar moment in which we live in the midst of COVID-19. The grief of death on Good Friday is met with weeks of living in the valley of the shadow of death. In some ways, we've been in Holy Week for weeks. And from this unrelenting, anxious stew, we face Jesus' death on a cross. And we know that crucifixion was a favored instrument, a slow, torturous death by the Roman Empire. They perfected its misery over 500 years, employing it especially against those they found guilty of insurrection or crimes against the state. A particularly cruel use of it occurred in 4 BCE in the land of Palestine. At that time, King Herod the Great died, sending Judea into waves of revolt. To quash it, General Verus, a Roman general, sent his legions throughout the land, particularly in Galilee, and crucified about 2,000 Jewish soldiers, rebels, according to the Roman Empire. When Jesus is born, the brutality of the Roman Empire is fresh. The memory of this carnage lingered in the air. And you know, I can't help but compare numbers. That number 2,000 Jewish people hanging on crosses. Just days ago, I think both on Monday and Tuesday, coronavirus deaths in the US alone came close to 2,000 people each day. And while that number is slightly tapering off, and we're getting hints that maybe the curve is slowly starting to flatten, we still have death in the air. And we hear disheartening news from many cities of the much higher proportional rates of death to this virus among the African American community. Death lingers in our air, albeit for very different reasons. So we have been living this holy week of impending death for weeks now. Calling to mind our embodied lives as they are. Let's turn to this next section of John's Gospel, and this is the crucifixion of Jesus. I read to you from the Gospel of John, chapter 19, verses 16b through 22, and I am reading from the New Revised Standard Version. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'this man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." This is the gift of God's word to us. Thanks be to God. So I wonder, did you notice how little attention the writer gave to the actual crucifixion event? In a brief sentence, the writer of John's Gospel notes, "There they crucified him," as if it's a small detail, a minor plot point. In a way, it is. All four Gospel accounts spend little ink describing it. But we know without Jesus' crucifixion, the major plot could not unfold. God's work in Jesus through resurrection at Easter. It may be the only place in this passage that John's Gospel syncs up with the others. Other details here reveal the Christ that the writer has been pointing to throughout his entire Gospel. This person, Jesus, who is both human and divine, present with God from the beginning of creation, acts with intentional, self-giving love in obedience to God, and is lifted up as the King of the Jews for the entire world. John's gospel points to this person, Jesus, who is both human and divine, present with God from the beginning of creation, acts with intentional, self-giving love in obedience to God, lifted up as the King of the Jews for the entire world. So here are two pieces that John adds to this unfolding resurrection story. The first is in those first couple verses, verses 16b and 17. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. Jesus carries the cross by himself. He's not assisted by Simon of Cyrene as he is in the other Gospels. The Jesus of John is clear-eyed about his death. Earlier in the Gospel, in one of his seven I Am statements, back in chapter 10, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord." A calm, resolute Jesus hefts his cross and walks to Golgotha outside the city. And then verse 18 follows. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Then these final four verses focus on the inscription, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. It's written in three languages, Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. In the hands of this gospel writer, Pilate unwittingly becomes a messenger of Jesus' kingship. The chief priest of the Jews, the common phrase the gospel writer uses to describe the Jewish leaders, they tell Pilate not to write this, but instead Pilate says, "What I've written, I've written." Now, an inscription upon crosses was common. You know, it labeled the crime for onlookers. And Jesus' crime, according to the chief priests, was to claim kingship over a Roman subject, in this case, the Jewish people, which was against Roman law and punishable by death. But Jesus' inscription didn't say blasphemer or rebel. It was a title, the title of king. By inscribing it, Pilate allowed for Jesus' kingship to stand, which is the point for John's gospel. And there's more to this inscription. It was written in three languages. Hebrew was the common language of the Jewish people. Greek was the language of commerce, education, philosophy. And Latin was the language of political power. Jesus is universally understood as king over all of it. In John's gospel, there is no government, no individual ruler, economic sector, school of thought, or religious belief that does not stand under the kingship of Christ. There is no corner of the world in which Christ does not reign. This king is victorious over all, fitting into the overall pattern in John's gospel of the cosmic Christ that we find in Colossians chapter 1, verses 19 and 20. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. I ask you, what are the languages we speak today over which Jesus' inscription reminds us of God's infinite reach? We can begin with the language before us in this pandemic. Social distancing, flatten the curve, a new meaning for stay at home. Or what about the language we're using to describe our days? Overwhelmed, sad, anxious, lonely, craving human touch, depressed, exhausted, exasperated, awash in our addictions. And there's also the good stuff, rested, peaceful, joyful, playful, enjoying time with family for long-awaited projects, grateful. The inscription reads for us, Jesus of Nazareth, King of all this, too. You'll notice if you touch the bottom of your screen, there's a chat button. Maybe some of you have been chatting throughout this time together. I invite you as you wish, while I continue talking. What word or phrase is your language over which you need to know Jesus of Nazareth, King of this, too? Go ahead and give me some words. And when I'm done and we're praying, I'll include them and pray for you too. From the particularity of our lives to the many peoples across the nations, to the ozone and plastic islands and parched land and scorched forests, the inscription reads for us, Jesus of Nazareth, King of all this, too. Take note, however, this is not a call to resign ourselves to lay back and wait for God to figure things out, since God's got this. The reign of Christ, God reconciling all things to God's self, calls upon us to draw ourselves ever closer to that reconciling work. It begins with trust in the one who said, I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep, and they know me. Good Friday comes, the day when we commit yet again all the sorrow and suffering into the hands of the one who went willingly, lovingly, to his own death. And from this death, God raises up a new creation, one that continues to be made manifest as the Spirit works in us and through us, that all would know Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, King of the world. I see some of you have written some chats. And so before we begin our prayer time, I'm going to take it upon myself to read some of the things that you have offered for our gathering. Blessed and tired, overwhelmed, King over our consumption and consumerism, fatherly advice in difficult times, scattered and confused. Let us pray. Christ, our King, you are the gate to the sheepfold, and you are the good shepherd. Through whatever language necessary, please draw us in. Jesus of Nazareth, you are King over blessed and tired, over overwhelmed. You are King over our consumption and consumerism, over fatherly advice in difficult times, over scattered and confused. Christ, our King, enfold us with your self-giving love, that we may not hoard it for ourselves, but reach with renewed minds and emboldened hearts to the lost, the lonely, the forgotten, and those same little selves within our own self. We pray for the sake of the world you love. Amen.
Good afternoon. My name is Tammie Wisniewski. I am a pastor serving at New Jerusalem Zion in Lenhartsville. I am also a member of Epler's Church here in Burn Township. I hope you are all well and safe and find the blessings in this holiday season. I turn us to John chapter 19. My verses are 23 through 27. Hear these words. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier, They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And then he said to his disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. The word of the Lord. Let us pray. May these words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, dear Lord. Amen. "There is something about those Marys" was a sermon title that I used a few years ago when we read scriptures on Mary Magdalene. We recognize in our tradition six Marys, at least: Mary, mother of Jesus; Mary Magdalene; Mary of Bethany; Mary, mother of James the younger; Mary of Clopas; and Mary, the mother of John Mark. This passage focuses on Mary, mother of Jesus; Mary Magdalene; and Mary of Clopas. Some traditions combine a couple of the Marys as if one person. I have learned that historically in that time, one in every five women were named Mary, which I guess is why there are so many Marys in the Bible. Makes sense, right? I've also learned that in Hebrew, Mary means wished for child. It means rebellion. It also means bitter. Now that's kind of appropriate, I think. Mary, mother of Jesus, and the other Marys had a lot to be bitter about, and they were rebellious. Flipped societal norms of their time, God-inspired pregnancy, and a so-called prostitute hanging out with the Son of God. But to me, it is the hearts of these Marys that is spoken about in this passage that moves me to tears. The heart of Jesus, that's what they had. That is what made them strong. Their hearts are what made them appear to be rebellious. Can you imagine their pain? Especially Mary, mother of Jesus. For the mothers out there, have you ever watched your son or daughter die? This child who you gave life to? Well, I have. And it's an unbearable pain. And I know that in this moment, this pain was all that they could consider. The unbearable pain of what Mary's child was going through and the desire to take it from him, but knowing that you can't. The pain of knowing that this is the last words you will hear your son speak. My son's last words, as they began to intubate him, "I will always hopefully remain in my head and in my heart. And I pray that I don't stop hearing them that moment," as he told me he loved me. But one thing I'm pretty sure not going through their heads as they sat there at the cross was their own future. The worry of how they will get along tomorrow or the days after that. But here we have Jesus in some of his final words, in the deepest physical pain that anyone can endure, making sure that his mother is taken care of. He transferred the reins of taking care of his mother to that disciple whom he loved and whom he trusted. Mary and Jesus, two hearts in tune with God, two hearts representing the love of God. I'm going to share with you a piece that Max Lucado wrote about a book called Just Like Jesus. He says, Jesus is pure, we are greedy. He is peaceful, we are hassled. He is spiritual, we are earthbound. The distance between our hearts and his seems so immense. How could we ever hope to have the heart of Jesus? Ready for a surprise? You already do. If you've given your life to Jesus, Jesus has given himself to you. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 16, strange as it seems, we Christians actually do have within us a portion of the very thoughts and mind of Jesus Christ. God has ambitious plans for us. The same one who saved your soul longs to remake your heart. And let's imagine what it means to be just like Jesus. Let's look long into the heart of Christ. Perhaps seeing in him, we will see what we can become. So may we look in this very isolated time to adopt this type of love as a spiritual practice. Looking out for one another, calling that neighbor or old friend that you haven't heard from in a while. And if it's safe and you're healthy, make sure your neighbors and family have the food and the prescriptions that they need. Maybe take care of one another. Christy?
I'm going to be singing Ave Maria, everyone.
Thank you. Let us close with a moment of silence as we lift up to the Lord our needs, our heart's desires, thinking about those Marys and the grief, as Nichole spoke about earlier. And then I will close with a word of prayer. Jesus, you traveled through towns and villages, curing every disease and illness. At your command, the sick were made well. Come to our aid now, in the midst of the global spread of the coronavirus, that we may experience your healing love. Heal those who are sick with the coronavirus or any illness. May they regain their strength and health through quality medical care. Heal us from our fear, dear Lord, which prevents nations from working together and neighbors from helping one another. Heal us from our pride, which can make us claim invulnerability to a disease that knows no borders. Jesus Christ, healer of all, stay by our side in this time of uncertainty and sorrow. Be with those who have died from the virus. May they be at rest with you in your eternal peace. Be those who struggle mentally and any other way staying home, and be with their caregivers. Give them peace. Be with the doctors and the nurses and the researchers and all medical professionals who seek to heal and help those affected and who put themselves at risk in the process. May they know your protection and peace. And be with the leaders of all nations. Give them the foresight to act with charity and true concern for the well-being of the people they are meant to serve. Give them the wisdom to invest in long-term solutions that will help prepare us prevent future outbreaks. May they know your peace as they work together to achieve it here on earth. Remind us of the joys in our lives, Lord, the opportunity to spend more time at home with our families. And whether we are home or abroad, surrounded by many people suffering from this illness or only a few, stay with us as we endure and mourn, persist and prepare. In place of our anxiety, give us your peace. And in the words of Ave Maria, Hail Mary, full of grace, Mary, full of grace. Hail, hail the Lord. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary. Hail Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, pray for us. Pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death, the hour of our death, the hour of our death. Hail Mary. Amen. Thank you.
would dwell in the shelter of the Lord, or abide in his shadow or light. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust, and God will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of God's hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your refuge, his faithfulness your shield, and God will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of God's hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come. And God will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of God's hand.
Can you hear me? Good. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, I am thirsty. A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, it is finished. Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. So I had planned to sing, O Sacred Head Now Wounded, but the Jacksons beat me to it. So good for them. It was beautiful. You know, one of the things about these kinds of services is when you get a little snippet of scripture is that it just begs to be picked apart. And when I read, when I look at this and I have questions, right? I think we all do, because there's so much minutia. What's hyssop? What's scripturing? Why? I always had thought it was sour wine. I mean, I asked these, so let me get to the questions. Okay. Hyssop was a wild mint. It was kind of bitter. It was used in a lot of different ancient rites of different cultures. Jewish rite of purification. It was ground up and put into food. It helped with digestion. It was kind of one of those all-around herbs that you could use to feel better. And the second, I'm thirsty, comes from Psalm 22. Has absolutely nothing to do with Jesus, other than that one little snippet of verse. And the third, I was right. In Matthew 27 and Mark 15, Jesus is offered vinegar with myrrh to ease his pain, which he refuses. So it's changed to wine. Often wasn't much difference, probably. So, questions answered, done. So I tried reading about this passage a little bit more and trying to understand it. Some of the scholarship that I was reading, they tried to turn this into a heroic act. Jesus wanting to moisten his throat for one last triumphant cry. And of course, I don't get that from this. I think Jesus was at the end of this horrible experience, this somewhat common form of torture and murder, a slow death that was done to make a point. Crucifixion was all about cruelty. And we know that. We experience that now. We see it regularly. But the message was, if you mess with Rome, then this is what's going to happen. And it also points out again that Jesus was actually murdered by the Romans in collaboration with some leaders from the Jewish community, but, you know, because he was threatening the realm. He was threatening the Pax Romana. Now, I always had this idea that Pax Romana was for most of the Roman Empire history, but in fact, it was only about 200 years long, and it started around 30 years before the birth of Jesus and ended around 180 AD. John Dominic Crossan, among others, have said that to say Jesus is the Son of God is to say that Caesar is not. And that was really the point. That was really the center of all of this that was happening. To say that we belong to God first is to say that everything else takes a back seat. And boy, we love to say that. You know, we love to push that. But the truth is, for most of us, we have a lot of allegiances in our lives. We have a lot of things that matter to us. We have family, we have friends, we have pets who are probably annoyed we're here right now because we've been here all week. It says that our country isn't co-equal. It comes after. It says that what's right is more important than what we're told is right. And the truth about that is that no leader really wants to hear that, do they? I have problems with the Gospel of John, I must admit. Every year I come around to this time, I try to figure out a better way to do this day. I get frustrated with John. If I were to, maybe you don't feel the same way, but I think a lot of people have a book of the Bible that they would probably like to remove. I know Luther did. And the heresies through the centuries were often around this. For me, it's most of the Gospel of John, to be honest. There's a lot of reasons. First of all, you know, blah, blah, blah. John just seems to go on and on sometimes when really it could be a lot shorter. I think people might say that about us on occasion. The whole predestination thing makes me crazy. I would be a terrible Calvinist. I'd leave. The anti-Semitism that this promotes is frustrating because when I read this in church, I try really hard to change the language, some of the Jews or the Jewish people. That term, the Jews, is the source of a lot of pain and suffering in history. And also, I think maybe the worst part of it for me is that this story gives Pilate a pass. It makes Pilate look like, oh gosh, I really would like to help, but gee, you know, what can I do? You want Barabbas? No, oh, I tried. He washes his hands. He's, you know, he's soft-pedaled. And the truth about Pilate, for anyone who loves history the way I do, is he was a horrible man. He could care less if he was hurting people. He could care less if he was inflicting damage on Jesus. It was just fun. It was about, again, the cruelty. But the truth is, when John is being written, and the Christian community is struggling to get its foothold. It's in competition probably with other types of Judaism. It still quite hasn't found its own way. Who are you going to mess with? Rome? No. No. You're going to mess with the people who are probably as weak as you are. You're going to blame the Jews. So I have a problem with it. But on the other hand, when I look at this passage, when I consider this story, the question that keeps coming back to me is the earlier question. What is truth? It's every seeker's question. It's every cynic's question. It's every thinking person's question. What is truth? I don't think that Pilate was wrong for asking that question. But I don't think it was hopeful. I think it was more cynical, more defeated. I think people in power often find that that power doesn't satisfy. And neither do people who are oppressed. I think we're all searching for truth. I think we're all thirsting. When Jesus says, "I thirst," you know, we can turn that into a metaphor if we'd like to, but for him, it was real. For us, we all thirst. We all, right now, I'm just like this uber extrovert who is thirsting for people, and I don't have it. I think we all can see the struggle that Jesus went through. So for me, while I get frustrated by this story and by some of the inaccuracies of it, I'm also really moved by it every time I read through it, because I think about my Lord. I think about how frustrated he must have been with his own followers. And I pray about that because I'm like them. One of my friends said, you know, give the disciples a break. I said, well, I see a lot in common with myself and them, with everybody and them. So I kind of do give them a break, and I kind of don't. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for these times, because I think they've pushed us into a new reality. They've forced us to think differently and do differently. You have given us an amazing opportunity, an opportunity to pull ourselves into the 21st century, an opportunity to do something wonderful like this. And thanks to those who had this great idea, to Bree and to Gary for putting it together. You force us to serve you in new and different ways, even though we might not want to. But you have given us a chance to make a different world. We pray, Lord, that we can do that. We pray, Lord, that we will have the will, as we see the environment cleaning itself up in just a few short weeks, as we see people struggling and realizing they need each other. We thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Steve. Our final reading then for this afternoon, still thinking I'm in church, for this afternoon is from John chapter 19, verses 31 through 42. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scriptures might be fulfilled. None of his bones had been broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one, because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. This final passage for this morning, for today, gives us the laying of Jesus in the tomb. There's a difference between the way that the two other crucified individuals were removed. Each of the other two had their legs broken as a way of quickening death. Jesus, however, had his side pierced as water and blood rushed out of his body so that the scriptures might be fulfilled. Now, for the author John, this was also symbolic. This represents the two sacraments that we believe in the United Church of Christ: baptism and Holy Communion. The water would represent the cleansing of our sinfulness from baptism. And the blood can represent the blood of Christ that we drink as we remember during our memorial meal of communion. There's a hymn that I'm going to sing the first verse of that goes with this scripture. Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin the double cure, save from wrath and make me pure. Now, after this moment of death, the removal of Jesus's body needed to be done quickly because it was almost the Sabbath and no work could be done on that day. The friends of Jesus were poor and could not have given him a fitting burial, but two men came forward, Jesus of Arimathea and Nicodemus. Now, Nicodemus is a significant person here because he was a faithful one, a faithful follower of Christ, but only in secret. Because Nicodemus is a man who came and asked Jesus questions all the way back in chapter 3. So these two individuals took Jesus and wrapped his body and prepared it for burial with a large amount of perfume. Really too much perfume for one burial, but it can help us to understand the amount of love that these two men had for Jesus. However, it wasn't necessarily the size of the gift of burial spices, but the care to which they wanted to preserve Jesus's body. Jesus was shown love by being placed in a pristine new tomb, while the other bodies of the crucified individuals were mutilated. At the end of our time together, we are reminded of the love that Jesus's followers had for him as they took good care of his body and placed it in the tomb. just as Jesus shows us his love for us with his death on the cross. I am now going to leave us all with a short video that depicts through sand art the crucifixion. Upon its completion, I will end our call together. But I pray that we will all go from this place and know the love that God has for us and the grace that Jesus gives to us. And may you take these next days to be in prayer and meditation as we together mourn the death of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.